Let's stand, and we're going to do the Mavatma for the last time with Mr. Caleb. Here we go.
Kids, let's show our parents the Mavama, the memory verse of the month. You ready? Let's go. Blessing and honor, glory and power to the one who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb forever and ever. Revelation 5:13. Mavama. Whoo! Thank you for coming.
Good morning, church family. Well, today we are here to celebrate baptism. We've said before, one of the reasons why baptism is such a significant event in the life of the church is because it's what marks the beginning of someone's walk with Christ. It's the sign of initiation, the sign that someone has put their trust in Christ and they are following Jesus now. And so today, as we celebrate with these two who've come to follow the Lord in baptism, that's what we're celebrating, their faith, that they are announcing that they follow Jesus. And so let me invite you now to turn your attention to the screen to see Emily's story.
My name is Emily Witt, and I am 8 years old. I accepted Jesus just a few months ago. Today I'm being baptized to show my faith in Jesus.
Well, many of you, yeah, you can clap. Well, many of you have known Emily from the moment she was born and watched her grow up, and we are so excited, Emily, for your faith in Jesus and to see how you've grown, and we're going to continue to cheer you on as you walk with Him. All right, so Emily, let me ask you, is Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right. Well, Emily, because of your faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus, it's my privilege to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ, raised to walk in new life with Him. Now let's watch Jerry's story.
Hi, my name is Jerry Gormley. I've been here at Mayfield Road for 20 years. I was raised Lutheran and because of that baptized as an infant. When I was in second grade, around 8 years old, I accepted Jesus with my family. In 1992, my best friend passed away, sort of unexpectedly. And when that happened, it was a very, very dark time for me. I felt very lost. I was sitting at home one day, and I looked down at the coffee table and noticed a Bible. It had always been there, but it just caught my attention. I picked up the Bible, started reading it, and just flipped through, just stopping here and there reading. And during that time reading the Bible, I just felt a peace come over me that I hadn't had during the whole period of time when my friend had died. And from that moment, I stood right there and I prayed and I accepted Jesus to come into my heart and to come into my life. And while I've been a Christian for many, many years, and I've even been nominated as a deacon in the past, I didn't feel like I was prepared and ready for that next step. But after speaking to family and friends and people in the church, and even a recent sermon, made me understand that this is a next step that I want to take in my spiritual life.
Church family, I just want to point out one thing. As many of you know, our church decided years ago that When we welcome church members from a different Christian tradition, we're not going to ask them to be rebaptized. We understand that in Christian faith, churches have different modes of baptism that they practice. We practice baptism by immersion, but we welcome members from different backgrounds. But as Jerry and I have talked, as he's been nominated to serve as a deacon, he felt like this is an important step in his following the Lord, to follow the Lord in baptism by immersion, as he follows the Lord and then begins to serve our church family as a deacon. And so as we talked about that, we want to honor his listening to the Spirit's guidance on that. And so today it's my privilege, Jerry, to baptize you. So Jerry, is Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior?
He is.
Well, because of your faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, it's my privilege to baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ, raised to walk in new life with him. And now let's continue to worship together.
Will you stand as we sing this morning? We're going to join with the angels in heaven as they sing "Holy, Holy, Holy" to our God.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning, our song shall rise to thee. Oh,
Hello, my name is Knox Blanchard, and I'm part of the student ministry here at Mayfield Road. Welcome to this time of worship. If this is your first time joining us, or if you have any prayer requests, please fill out the Connect card found in the pew rack in front of you. You may also scan the QR code in the pew rack to access the card online. For you watching online, a link to that card is provided in the title of this post. We also want to thank you for your continued financial support of the ministry here at Mayfield Road. There are three ways you can give: through our website, by bank bill pay, or in person by dropping it in the offering boxes located outside these doors and throughout the facility. Thank you again for joining us in person and online this morning. We invite you to continue worshiping with us.
Will you stand as we sing?
Sing a new song to him.
Good morning, church family. It's good to be with you this morning to celebrate the Lord, celebrate His goodness, His kindness to us. As we gather, we want to, of course, be in prayer for those in our church family. We've got several that are in rehab of different types, Elizabeth Brewer and a few others that we need to be praying for. Also need to make you aware, Christine Mackin, who, a member of our church, not been able to come for some time, but she passed away this past week, and we'll be getting information out about her service, but you want to pray for the Mackin family. As we continue in our worship this morning, I want to direct our attention to Isaiah chapter 6, that envisions God on His throne. Like we sing about here in the song just now, but it reminds us who our God is. Sometimes our understanding or our picture, our mental image of God is a lot smaller, a lot more familiar or contained than is really true. God is far bigger than our imagination, and sometimes we need to be reminded of that. In Isaiah chapter 6, the prophet Isaiah wrote that in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of His robe filled the temple. Above Him were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, saying, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of His glory. At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and the thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. Woe to me, I cried, I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, See, this is touch your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for. When we come before the Lord, we are in over our heads. We're beyond our pay grade. He's holy beyond even our understanding. We don't have a right to be in His presence except through our faith in Jesus. We have access to God. He welcomes us and adopts us as His children and says, come and enjoy my presence. That's why we celebrate Him. Let's pray together this morning. Father, we thank You that You are so far above our understanding, so far above our imagination, so far above our concept of holiness and goodness and love and truth. But because of what You've done through Jesus, You've made it possible for us to be welcomed into Your presence, not just to stand on the periphery, but to draw near to You. And so, Father, this morning, we want to enjoy that. We want to live in response to that. We want our worship to draw near, that our hearts would be open to You, that we would be in Your presence. And so we pray that You would fix our minds and fix our hearts on You. We love You. We thank You for who You are. We thank You that we have the privilege of gathering together as Your people. And so we pray for Your presence to be made known to us this morning. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sight to the blind, I believe that the dead came to life. I believe there were wonders and signs, and you're still the same. I believe every word that you said. I believe there are scars in your hands, that your goodness is good without end, and you'll never change. And all generations bow down and praise. The Lord is faithful, yesterday, now, and always, always. I believe you will come in the clouds. I believe you are here even now. In your presence I know there is power, power to save. Yeah. I will tell of your wonders, sing of your grace. The God of creation knows me by name. The Lord is faithful, yesterday, now, and always, always. Your mercy is mighty, age after age, and all generations bow down and today, now, and always, always. Yesterday, now, and always.
Oh,
Let's pray together. Father, we do praise you for your faithfulness, because you always keep your word. There's never been a time, Father, where we have put our trust in you and it was misplaced. You're always faithful, not just to do what you say you're going to do, but you're faithful to who you are. You're always true to your character. And we celebrate that about you because you're good. Your character is good. Your promises, they hold us fast when nothing else will. Father, we thank you for that. We honor you for who you are. And our prayer, Father, is that this morning as we open your word, that we would live in response to who you are and the way you've demonstrated your love to us. And that you would shape us to be men and women and boys and girls who reflect your character to a world that needs it. So speak to us this morning, Father. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I trust you all had a good Thanksgiving and a good time with loved ones. Maybe heard some old family stories or old folk yarns that were passed down. There's a lot of wisdom in listening to some of the old folk stories that a family has, or that maybe it's part of your family history, or maybe it's just kind of part of, you know, where you grew up. There's some old stories that get passed down that sometimes have an awful lot of wisdom that you want to hold on to. There's one story, and it's told in a lot of different traditions, so you may have heard this one before, but it's the old story about this young man. He goes into his grandmother and he starts complaining about how hard his life is. And he's saying, "Man, my classes are brutal. They're just killing me. It's hard." And if that was all I had to deal with, that'd be one thing. But classes are hard, but then my job, I've got to work to, you know, pay bills and all that. My job is hard. It's just, there's unnecessary stress for, you know, the kind of work I got to do, but it's, you know, that's hard. And then just like the price of everything, meeting everything, you're like, it's not just that I have to support myself, but everything keeps going up and it's just hard. Making ends meet is hard. And so everything is hard. Having time for a social life, that's hard. I'm a Razorback fan and that's hard. Like, there's just a lot of hard things. And so this wise grandmother's listening, and she doesn't say anything. But she goes over to the cabinet, and she gets out three pots, fills them with water, and puts them on the stove. Into the first pot, she drops a potato. Into the second pot, she puts an egg. In the third pot, she puts a handful of tea leaves. And she sets them all to boil. After a while, she turns the stove off, pulls the pots off, and then says to her grandson, "Here, take a look at these." She said, that potato now, tell me about it." He pulls it out. He's like, "It's soft." "Yeah. Take a look at that egg." Cracks it open. It's hard. "Look in the pot with the tea leaves. You know, it's just, you know, a good kind of light brown." She said, "Those pots were all the same. Same circumstances. I dropped the potato, the egg, and the tea leaves into the exact same situation. But there were properties in each one that were different. That boiling water revealed something about each one of those three properties that was unique. The boiling water made the potato soft. It made the egg hard. And the tea leaves, it changed the circumstances." And so she looked at him and she said, "What are your circumstances revealing about you?" And the lesson was done. You know, we learn a lot more about ourselves and those around us when we're in hard circumstances than when everything is going okay. We might prefer the good days where everything's up and to the right, you know, where your team wins by 50, when like you're on track for your bonus, when everything is just perfect, where nothing was overcooked, everything came out perfect, you know, there was no arguments around the table, everyone was happy and harmonious. We like those days. Those days are great. But as one business leader said, we can't tell anything about you when everything is going well. It's when things are going bad, when circumstances are kind of taking a downturn, when things get tough, that's when we see who you really are. That's when your character and your values are revealed, when things get tough. And so that the question maybe is, what do you do when you feel like the pressure's on? When you feel like your back is against the wall? When you feel like the world is against you and everything's like pushing on you and like it's getting tough, what do you do then? Do you spring into action? Do you circle the wagons, call a team meeting, and start strategizing? Do you go into denial mode? It's fine, nothing's wrong, it's fine. Or do you try to bury the pressure with a gallon of ice cream? You know, there's a time and place for all those, most of those. But we're going to see today, it's not just people that, like, hard circumstances reveal a lot about, but groups of people, the church. You see, we're going to see a time today where the early church was in a hard time, where the pressure's on, they feel their back's against the wall, and that revealed something about them. And that's important because we love celebrating, and we love looking at, like, a few weeks ago, we looked at the passage in Acts 2 where it talks about just the amazing way God's at work in the church, and people are coming to faith in Christ, and unbelievable things are happening. People are generous toward one another. It's a beautiful, harmonious picture. We read that, and we're like, that's amazing. I want to be part of that. And that's great. We see God's power at work then. But also, there's something that we see and we learn when the pressure's on and when this little church is facing intense pressure. It reveals something about who they are as God's people. It reveals something about their character that we need to see and we need to learn from. And so if you have your Bibles this morning, let me ask you to go ahead and turn to Acts chapter 4. Boys and girls, if you're following in your One Big Story Bible, that's going to be on page 1102. Now in this series, we've been working our way through the book of Acts, seeing how the message of Jesus rippled out and spread throughout the world, how Jesus entrusted his work to his followers, and by his Spirit empowered them to carry it on. A few weeks ago, we saw how Peter and John went to the temple courts one day and healed a beggar. And everybody was amazed by that. So they came to Peter and John and said, how did this happen? Peter took the opportunity to announce the message of Jesus there, and hundreds, thousands became Christians. So at that point, the church has grown from just a handful of, 120 people. By this point, it's over 5,000. So the message of Jesus has been spreading. Great things have been happening. The people are amazed. But the religious leaders take notice, and they're not impressed. They have Peter and John arrested. They take them before the Sanhedrin, the kind of the Jewish Supreme Court, and they tell them to cut it out. Stop healing and announcing and like proclaiming the name of Jesus. Stop saying this guy that was crucified is risen. Stop saying that he's the Messiah. Just cut it all out. And we saw last week how Peter and John, they stood with boldness. They say, you decide what's right to do, to listen to you or to God. We can't help it. We're going to speak about what we've seen and heard. And we celebrate that. Like, that's applause worthy. That kind of boldness is inspiring to watch. But then it says
the Sanhedrin, they threatened them and released them. And then Peter and John had to go back to the church, to their group of fellow Christ followers. And they had to say, this is what's happened. And this is what they're threatening us with. And then kind of reality hits. And they realize things are going to change. The pressure's on. And remember, this group, this council, the Sanhedrin, these are the ones who have Rome's backing. These are the powers that be. This is the group that sent Jesus to Pilate and had him crucified. They've got position. They've got power. They're the ones who are really pulling the strings. And this group of Christ followers, yeah, they've been growing. Yeah, they've got 5,000 people or so. But it's still only no more than like a fifth of the population. They're still a minority player, and they don't have position. They don't have power. They don't have a whole lot of strings to pull. And so what do? When the world is against them, telling them to quit. We pick up reading in verse 23. It says, on their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. Sovereign Lord, they said, you made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of your servant, our father David. And then they quote from Psalm 2. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth rise up and the rulers band together against the Lord and against his anointed one. They continue in the prayer. Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus. After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. So when they're under threat, when the powers that are ruling the world, that are calling the shots, are against them, when they're pushed into a corner and their back is against the wall, they don't get together and start saying, who do we know to like be an advocate for us? They don't start saying, what can we do to like marshal a legal defense? They don't go on a counterattack. They don't launch some kind of a smear campaign against the Supreme Court. They say, there's one thing to do. And they gather together and they pray. And that was enough. Because the pressure that was on reminded them where their power comes from. Prayer reminds us where our power comes from. It's not from our influence or organizational savvy. It's not from some kind of economic power that we can, you know, influence the markets. Our power doesn't come from our connections or positions to those who are high up. Now look, there's nothing wrong with at times God places his people where we do have connections or where we do have influence, where we do have resources at our disposal. And there are times where we see even later on in the book of Acts where Paul's going to use some of his resources, some of his connections. He's going to use the benefits or privileges that come with his citizenship. Like, there are times where it's appropriate for us to use the different means at our disposal in order to, you know, to carry on, in order to carry on our mission, or in order to face injustice when we're attacked. There's times where that's appropriate. But the threat or the challenge for us is when we're constantly going and saying, what can I do? How can I solve this? What do I have in my pockets that I can empty out to get things done? The threat is it becomes awful easy for us to start saying, it's all up to me. It's awful easy for us to start thinking that this, what I have available, this is where the power comes from. It's up to me and my ingenuity. It's up to us and our creativity as a people. It's up to us to be able to figure this out on our own. And when we get to a spot where our resources run out, then we don't know what to do. Where do we go? And what this passage shows us is when God's people were in a position as a minority people, when they were in a position of little to no influence, when they were in a position where their backs were against the wall and they didn't have an advocate to turn to bail them out, when they were in a stuck spot, they turned to God in prayer. And that was what they needed. They found they did have an advocate in the ruler of heaven and earth. They found that God gave them what they needed in order to lead them through and in order to empower them to continue on with the mission he gave them. And that's what we've got to remember. God's given us a lot. God's entrusted us with a lot of resources at our disposal. But when the pressure's on, we need to remember our power doesn't come from the resources in our hands. Our power comes from the ruler of heaven and earth who's empowered us to continue on in his work. And so that's why prayer matters. That's why we need to be a people of prayer. You know, we've seen how this works in the life of our church. Back at the end of last year, I was reflecting on, like, where we've been. We'd come through a couple of hard years, and God had led us through and provided, and it was like, okay, thank you, Lord, for where we've been, but where are you leading us now? I started praying about, what's this, what is something that, like, where would God lead us? What should we be praying about? What should we be looking toward in the year ahead? And so felt like the Lord put three things on my heart. And so the very first Sunday of January this year, I preached from this passage, and we began praying for three things as a church. Y'all remember that? Well, I hope so. It hadn't been that long. All right, here's a reminder. We began praying that in this year, the Lord would allow us to see 12 baptisms. We began praying that God would bring us a new student pastor. We were in a search and had been for a while. And then we began praying that each member of our church would take their next step in their journey with Jesus. We said, we don't know what it is, you know, that, but every one of us, you know, as followers of Christ, one of the things, like the primary thing we're called to do is follow Christ. There's a series of steps in following him day by day. And we believe each one of us have a next step God's calling us to. So we begin praying that. We begin praying that God would allow us to see these three things happen in the life of our church. And if you remember, we got to about end of February, March. It's like, are we going to see an answer? But we kept praying. And then we began to see answers to prayer. And so, just a recount, this morning we baptized numbers 13 and 14. And so God answered that prayer. That's the most baptisms that we've had in my time being here at the church. We're grateful for that. That's an answered prayer. New student pastor, back in May, we announced that the Lord had led us that Philip, who's serving as our children's pastor, we recognized that, hey, God's already provided us with the one that we're looking for. And so we expanded his duties. He is our full-time family pastor, taking on ministry from preschool children and students, and has done a fantastic job with that. And so we've seen how God provided in just making it clear to him and to us, and just in the last few months of moving toward that transition, we've seen God's hand on our family ministry. And we're grateful for that. Grateful for those of you who have stepped up and come alongside Philip and helped to carry on the work. It's a team ministry, and so we need you. So thank you for that. The third one, each member taking their next step, maybe is a little harder to gauge. It's not one of those metrics we can measure so precisely or have done. But in talking with various ones of you over the course of the last few months, several of you talked about, I'm still praying about what my next step is, or some of you said, hey, I think this is what my next step might be. And so we have a few of our members that have identified their next step and want to share it with you. And so let me ask you to direct your attention to the screen, and let's hear from a few who have identified their next step.
Hi, I'm Vic Travis. I've prayed for some time about what the Lord wanted me to do. I live in an area where there's a lot of elderly people. And I thought for a long time that it'd be nice to have a good Bible study here for those people. And sure enough, prayed about it, and the Lord answered my prayers. And now for about close to a year now, what I do is I take our Sunday school lesson that we have on Sundays, and I turn around and apply it to them. I have a young group of people. I got one that's 94-year-old, one 92-year-old, and several in their 80s. And so they're hard to deal with. I mean, they're rowdy, but I enjoy doing it. And the Lord led me to this, and I am so grateful.
You know, God has already helped me through my trials that I've been going through lately, and really showing me the right path to really be on as a Christian. I think that now that I've gotten through so many hurdles that I've had to jump over, whether it came to my own sin or just things that were holding me back from him in general, it's now really time for him to come into my life and start working through me. And I feel like my next step is figuring out that aspect of how am I going to use my gifts, like my music and things of that nature, for his ministry. So that's where I feel like my next step is. I've been praying about it a lot, and yeah, that's where I'm at.
God helped me to take the next steps this year by giving me the ability to write notes during the sermon so I can absorb all of the information, and giving me the resources to actually create a prayer board so I can keep track of those who need it, and to kind of keep track of how God answered prayers and everything like that. He also gave me the courage this year to invite people, my friends, to church, and now I have a friend who comes as often as she can.
Hi, I'm Jeanette Reed, and my next step is teaching the ladies Bible study.
I'm Bob Adams, and I'm happy to be serving on the personnel committee.
I'm Jeremiah Chauvin, and my next step is serving in the choir.
I'm Amy Charlotte, and my next step is serving on the finance committee.
I'm Anita Gormley, and my next step is teaching a new life group.
I'm Randy Pope, and my next step is serving as a deacon.
I'm Philip Strauman, and my next step is serving in the choir and serving at the food bank.
My name is Bea McLean, and my next step will be to lead the preschool choir, which is something I've grown to love.
Now, I've had conversations with others of you, I know, have taken your next steps, and maybe some of you are still, like, praying, I'm not quite sure what my next step might be. Well, you got a month and, like, 4 days. So there's plenty of time. But guys, we prayed for this. And did God answer? Yes, He did. Now, this wasn't anything that was born out of our own ingenuity. This wasn't anything where we just said, hey, let's pull together incredible strategic thinking. Let's do the resources. We prayed, and God answered. And there's nothing wrong with, again, having influence, having our God's given us a mind to use. God's given us creative, gifted people to use their gifts. God's given us a lot, but we have to remember our power comes not through what we have, but what God gives. God answers in response to our prayers. And so as we move forward, we want to continue to be a church that prays, a church that prays for God's direction, for His guidance, for His leading us into the future. Because ultimately, He's the one who enables us to do what He's called us to do. And so a few things for us to pray as we think about moving forward, prayers for us in the weeks ahead. Number one, prayers for us to end the year in a financially good position. Just like all of us, costs have gone up for the church. And we've had a few big ticket repairs, all of that. I know that's not very exciting to talk about, but our God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. He's the one who provides. Just like with our families, when we're at a tight spot and we need God's provision, the answer is to pray. As a church family, we can pray for God's provision for us, that we can have what we need in order to continue the work that He's calling us to do. Another thing we can pray about, clarity for us, for our next steps as a church. Because just like all of us, following Jesus is a step-by-step thing. For us as a church family, we want to follow His guidance. We want to continue to listen to His voice and follow His guidance. Because He's continuing to lay out His plans for us, and we want to be in tune with that. We don't want to script our own plan and ask God to bless it. We want to listen to His direction and go where He's leading us. And then as we move into our Christmas season, maybe one more thing that we can pray is pray that this year that we would honor Jesus in all of our celebration and that we would welcome others around the manger. That we would welcome others to celebrate the gift that God's given us. That God would continue to work through our friendships, through the people in our circle, the people that we've been reaching out to, those that are close to us, that we've been praying for and encouraging. That God would work through us, that we would reach our one, the people in our lives who are near but don't yet follow Christ. That this Christmas season, we might have an opportunity just to invite someone to come be part of the celebration with us. Those are some things that we can pray about together. As a church family, this is who we want to be, though. We want to be a people of prayer. Because God's the one who directs and empowers His church. And just like He did for these believers here in a tough spot, when they turned to Him in prayer, God answered. The place where they were meeting was shaken, and they went out and proclaimed the message of Jesus boldly. As we go forward, as we rely not on our own efforts or ingenuity, but on His, that's where the power comes from. And so let's ask God to direct us in the weeks ahead. Father, we thank You that You are faithful to work through Your people, that You hear and answer prayer. God, we thank You that we don't have to rely on our own capabilities, but instead we turn to you and rest on your power. We remember that we are your people, called by your name, empowered by your Spirit to do your mission. And so, Father, we thank you for how you've shown yourself faithful and powerful over the last 11 months. We thank you for the way that you've answered the prayers that we prayed, the way that we've seen you at work, the way that you have drawn men and women and boys and girls to faith in you, the way that you've allowed us to see them take next steps of obedience, the way that you provided the right student pastor. Father, you've answered our prayers, and we're thankful for that. But we pray that you'd continue to lead us forward, because the mission you entrusted to your church here so long ago is what we're a part of. And we want to be obedient to what you've called us to. And so we ask that you would provide for our needs, that you would direct us in the way you'd have us to go. And we pray that this Christmas season, Father, you would allow us to welcome others, to celebrate the gift of Jesus with us. Father, give us opportunities to point people to you. God, we thank you for how faithful you are. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this morning as we wrap up, we're going to sing together. If you're here and you want to learn more about putting your trust in Christ, or maybe joining our church or following the Lord in baptism like Jerry and Emily did this morning, what we'd ask you to do, there's the connect card there in the seat rack in front of you. You'll pull that out, you can fill it out, and on the back side, there's a spot where you can mark, I want to learn more about becoming a Christian, or I want to join our church. If you'll fill that out and mark it, you can turn it in at the end of the service and we'll follow up with you. But this morning as we sing, let's ask that the Lord would continue to work among us, that we would rely on His strength, that He would empower us for the mission that He's given to us, that He would continue to guide us in His way. Let's stand and sing together this morning.
To God be the glory, great things He hath done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life in atonement for sin, and opened the blind gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear His voice.
Thank you much. Y'all can be seated. Again, want to thank you for worshiping with us today. If you filled out that Connect card, we'll just remind you, you can drop that in the offering boxes on your way out either door this morning, and we'll follow up with you. If you're here, you'd like to pray with somebody about a need in your life, maybe there's something going on that we can pray together about. Sometimes the scripture says where two or three gather and ask it in Jesus' name, he hears and responds to that prayer. If that's something that we can serve you by, we'd love to pray with you. I'll be down here at the front with some of our deacons, and so stop by and we'd be glad to serve you in that way. A few announcements for us this morning. First of all, tomorrow morning we're going to be decorating the church for Christmas, and if you're available and would like to come and help, we would love to have your help with that. We're going to be here from 8:30 till noon. Is that right?
Hopefully shorter. Yes.
Shorter, all right. So it depends on how motivated you are. So if you can come and help us with that, we'd appreciate that. Then on Thursday, we're going to have a packing party. And if you recall, a few weeks ago, we said for our project for Christmas this year is we are providing all the students of Lynn Hill Elementary with stocking caps, gloves or mittens, and socks. And we have all that we need for every student on the campus, 350 or so kids, to have stocking cap, gloves or mittens, and two pairs of socks. And so we're going to be packing those bags this Thursday and then taking them over next Tuesday. So great way for us to serve all of the kids at Lynn Hill Elementary and just remind them that they are loved, they are prayed for. And so that's going to be this Thursday at 9:30 in Bridges Hall. And so if you're available, we'd love to have you help us with that. And finally, we have five new deacons that are going to be joining our deacon ministry. And so we're going to have a deacon ordination service a week from tonight, at 4 o'clock, I should say, on next Sunday. And that's a special time. And so if you're able, be sure to go ahead and mark that down so you can be here and celebrate and honor celebrate God's faithfulness in continuing to raise up more in our church family to serve as deacons. So, all right, I believe that's it. So, Lee, let me turn it over to you.
All right. Thank you for being here today. Let's stand. Also, before we sing, remember, these flyers are out there and out there. Take them away from here and give them to somebody else. Invite them to be a part of our Christmas. Let's stand as we sing together. Thank you. Have a great day.